welcome to DrupalCon Baltimore. We are so excited that you're all here together this week. It's such a special time for us to celebrate Drupal and learn from each other, and most importantly, come together as a community. And DrupalCon is made by staff and so many volunteers coming together and working hard for over a year to make this week happen. So I'd like to invite everyone that helped create DrupalCon to please stand up so we can thank you. So I know we have many people here. Thank you so much. It's going to be a magical week like it always is. The Drupal Association's mission is to unite the community to help you all come together to build and promote the software. And the Drupal Association does this through Drupal.org and DrupalCon. And our staff are really inspired by the community. And we cherish what you've created, both the software and how you've all organized and connect together to make this happen. And we're so proud that we are able to support all of you through DrupalCon, as well as Drupal.org, and help you amplify your successes and to support the community, as well as celebrate all the community heroes out there. And I'd like to just touch on that briefly. So this community has worked so hard to create amazing software, and you use it in so many ways. And you create it in a way that you really delight both your customers and your citizens and your patients and so many other kinds of people that are using Drupal as their solution. And the Drupal Association wants to really amplify those successes because we want to help celebrate what you've achieved. And we also want to help other people choose Drupal. And so you'll see at DrupalCon this week, we're amplifying your successes through case studies in all of the tracks. And it's amazing to see all the different companies that are using Drupal, from YMCA, to Pinterest, to Blue Cross Blue Shield. And I really encourage you to take the time to go to these sessions and learn from the experts who built these websites. And then on Drupal.org, we've also recently released industry pages that show you the power of Drupal in higher ed and government, as well as media and publishing. And we're going to be creating several more over the next couple months. And I had the privilege of creating some of these pages. I did the user research, and that meant I had to call on a lot of customers to find out why they chose Drupal. And actually, many of those people I talked to are in the room today. And one of the questions I would ask is, why did you choose Drupal? And there were lots of different reasons that people chose Drupal, and it ranged from flexibility, scalability, to security, and you know, lots of other different reasons. But one thing that everyone agreed on is that they chose Drupal because of the community, because of all of you. And they said that was because of your passion and your innovation, that they realized that Drupal's secret sauce is the community that's making the software. And I think that's just really important for all of you to know. And it's also kind of what brings us back to what helps get the Drupal Association staff up out of bed every day. It's really to support you, the community. And our community is beautiful in so many ways. And community work, it's hard. And it can get messy, sometimes even maddening. But that's okay, because we always stay together and work through things. And the Drupal Association wants to be part of that. And we're listening as we are working through different conversations right now in the community. And we want to help remove any roadblocks that get in the way from us being the best community that we can be. And so you'll see that in our programming here this week at DrupalCon. And first of all, I should have put up the pre-note. That was a pretty amazing pre-note for any of you who got to witness that. So we also have community discussions, which is a new track that we added just in the last couple days. We want the community to come together to have open discussions about the changes and the needs in our community. We're going through a transformational time, and together we're going to figure out how we can create a new governance model, as well as other things that the community needs as we mature and grow. And so I encourage you to check out the community discussions that will be mediated by Whitney Hess and participate. They're going to be, I think, really helpful for all of us. And then we also have the community speaker stage where community members are sharing some great wisdom in the exhibit hall, so I hope you'll go check that out. We also have Birds of a Feather, which are sessions where you get to pick the topic and people can come and join you and share different ideas. But we have identified some BOFs that are going to be specifically around community leadership and inclusion. So please check those out as well. And then we have the Being Human track. And this is a really wonderful track about self-management and learning all the tools of how to manage work-life balance and how to work with others and conflict resolution and just so many great things that can help us be stronger as a community. And then, of course, we have the contribution sprints at the very end of the event on Friday, so I hope you'll join us. We have mentors of your noob, in case you missed that in the pre-note. But we have lots of programs set up specifically to help this community come together in a very healthy way and move forward. On Drupal.org, there's so many ways that we help the community, and I'm not even doing our engineering team justice for all the things that they have been doing in the last year. But one thing that I really want to highlight is one of their recent milestones, which is evolving the project application process. So it used to take a developer months and months and months to submit a module or whatever it might be. And you know, it might even just sit there until someone can review it or not review it and just get stuck. And that really, you know, just doesn't feel good. It's frustrating. It's a real blocker. And the engineering team worked with the security team to open up those doors and change the process. So now when you have a great idea, you can just submit it and share it with the community. And I'm really excited to see what kind of impact that's going to have on all of the developers in the community. And so this also takes us to all of the heroes who help make our community what it is today. And there's so many ways to celebrate them, and there's so many people to celebrate. It was really hard for me to actually just pick the ones that I wanted to highlight today. So I did find three that I thought were really special. One is Martha Contreras. She ran the Drupal Camp Mexico recently in Guadalajara, and she not only grew the camp, but she included Global Training Days, which is a special program that helps onboard newbies into the community, and that helps us grow. So very thankful what she's done there. And then Tom Tran launched the first Drupal camp in Vietnam. And it's just amazing to see Drupal's growth in that part of the world. So we're just really thankful to have a leader like him step up to bring everyone together and show them the power of Drupal. And then the other person I wanted to highlight was Narcisse Bunzama. He created the first Drupal camp in the Democratic Republic of the Congo. And so it's just exciting to see someone take an idea and create a new community and create this event that goes behind it. And the reason I chose these three is that the association had the honor of giving each of them a community grant, which gives them funds to get started, whether it's securing a venue or it's getting that coffee that everyone needs. And you know, what I really want to point out is that while we help give them the funds to make these events happen, that money comes from you. It comes from the ticket sales, and it comes from membership to the Drupal Association. And we just love being in a position where we can kind of crowdsource all of the giving and help make these kinds of stories happen. And I'm really excited that we can make more this year with other leaders around the world. And another way that we celebrate community heroes is with the Aaron Winborn Award. And Aaron Winborn was a longtime community member who lost his fight to ALS a few years ago. And in his honor, we created this award. And so I ask for you to stay tuned and come back here on Thursday for closing session, where we're going to announce who the next person is that's going to receive this award. And in the meantime, I just really ask all of you to have a wonderful time at DrupalCon. This is a very special week to see old friends and make new friends, to learn all kinds of great new skills, and again, most importantly, to come together as a community. So thank you so much for your time, and I am just going to run through some housekeeping slides so that you kind of know the key tips while you navigate your way through the event today. So on social media, we do a lot on Twitter. So this is our handle, and shortly Dries is going to be coming up to speak. And when it's time for the Q&A, use hashtag Driesnote. And of course, check out Facebook. And if you're taking pictures, we encourage you to post them up on our official Flickr account. Something tells me you've already figured out the Wi-Fi, but here it is just in case. We just ask that you use one device at a time and no hotspots, please. We don't want to bring down the Wi-Fi. And also, please remember that we have all accepted code of conduct as we bought our tickets. And if you'd like to get more information about the code of conduct, you can find it in your program guide as well as on the website. And if you need to contact someone, we have George Demet and Liz here on site. And they're willing to step in and help you if you need it. And we can also submit any online reports to the community working group as well. And don't forget, after the Driesnote, stick around. We're going to take that group photo for everyone. And of course, we all need our coffee. And so we have free coffee in the exhibit hall. And so please go and take advantage of that. And thanks to Isovera, who helped underwrite that today. Yeah, you can shout out to them. Excellent. All right, and lunch. So lunch is from 12 to 2. This is new. It gives us more time to decide when we want to eat and when we want to go to sessions. It's going to be in the exhibit hall. And if you did not order a special meal, please don't take a special meal because we only have enough for those that ordered it. And just be, you know, mindful of which line you're getting into as well, because the buffets do include gluten and dairy-free options, but desserts are at the special meals desk. So good luck with that. I think it's pretty clear. And again, lunch was underwritten by SiteGround, so thank you for sponsoring. And of course, we want to meet as many of you as we can. So please stop by the Drupal Association booth to pick up your t-shirt. And while you're there, you can meet the local Baltimore group, the Drupal Diversity and Inclusion group, as well as the Sprint Mentors. And as I mentioned, we have Birds of a Feather. Please check them out. We have all kinds of great topics already on the board. And if you're looking for the Birds of a Feather board, you want to go on the 300 level near the top of the escalators. And I also mentioned the community speaker stage. There are some really great topics that I wanted to call out. I think I might check out the work-life balance one. I think that sounds pretty good. You might find some others that sound appealing to you as well. And again, I mentioned the community discussion sessions. They're going to be held today from 12 to 1, again at 2:15, and then the last one will be at 5 o'clock. And we do have certain capacities for each room, so just check out the website and decide which one's best for you. I really do hope that you'll go. They're going to be really productive. But I also want to make sure you can find it. So we added this at the last minute, so it is not in the central area. My recommendation is you go up to the third level, and you go all the way across through the skywalk, and then down the 200 level, and you'll see the Pratt Street show office. And we have wayfinding to help you get over there as well. Whoops. And so at the end of each of our sessions, it's really important that you remember to add your image to a slide. I did that for you. Yep. Anyhow, this way you won't forget that at the end of your session, please fill out the evaluation form, because this is how the speakers get better and better. They really do want your feedback. So thank you, and thank you for your grace and that little faux pas. All right, contribution sprints. So all week, you can sprint in room 301 to 303 until 6 p.m., but of course, we have the 24-hour sprint lounge, and that is at the Hilton Baltimore. And then on Friday is the first time sprint workshop, and we have all the mentors that are coming to help as well, and they have the core sprint, the mentored core sprint from 9 to 6, and the general contribution sprint for everyone is also from 9 to 6. So I do encourage you, as someone who's gone through this process, and I am not very technical, I really do encourage you to meet the sprint mentors beforehand and find out how you can set up and be really prepared for Friday. All right, let's talk about the social event. So Women in Drupal is tonight. And yeah, shout out for that event. So this is a great way to celebrate diversity and inclusion, and all attendees are invited to join us. Come to Lucky's Tavern tonight from 6 to 8. And then we have some other social events. There's the CXO dinner that's hosted by Michael Cannon of Accelerant. And we have Drinks with a Mission by Kalamuna and Four Kitchens and Manati. And of course, there's the after party from MediaKern and Lingotech. And then make sure you have on your calendar trivia night, which is this Thursday. The doors open at 8. And the trivia time is from 9 to midnight. All right. So I think those are all the tips. And now just a moment to thank our sponsors. So yes, you can go ahead and clap for our sponsors. So I just want to point out that we have a really affordable conference, but we get to do a lot of special things. And that's because our sponsors are underwriting a big portion of this event. And so not only are they helping to make us all, you know, giving us the opportunity to come together and make it affordable and lowering barriers for all kinds of people to join us, but they have great advice, excellent experience. So if you're here to learn, you want to talk to our sponsors and find out what they can do for you and how they can help you get to the next stage in your project. So a big thank you to our diamond sponsors and our platinum sponsors, our golds, and all of our bronzes. Sorry, I'm very bad with my clicker. I want to give the modules a chance to be seen. Okay, this is not working. All right, and then we also have all of our supporters. So raise your hand if you use Drupal.org or you get benefit from Drupal.org. I need to see every hand up because that's where the software is made. Yeah. This is what our team gets to help take care of, and we are so proud to be stewards of Drupal.org. But it costs a lot of money, like millions, right? And so how do we pay for that? Our supporters. Our supporters come together and they crowdsource the costs or the funding that covers the cost for Drupal.org. So a big thank you to our supporting partners. And now I'd like to thank our sponsors for the day, FFW. We have Ricardo Osuna, the Director of Marketing and Communications, and Ray Saltini, who's the Director of the Center of Excellence.
Thank you, Megan. Good morning, DrupalCon. You look marvelous. DrupalCon as far as the eye can see. I am Ray Saltini, Director of the FFW Center of Excellence.
And I'm Ricardo Osuna. I'm the Director of Marketing and Communications at FFW. And we are a global digital agency that works with Drupal across 13 countries, As Megan mentioned, we're proud to be a signature supporting partner of the association, as well as a diamond sponsor of DrupalCon Baltimore.
And we get the privilege of starting off, helping to start off DrupalCon Baltimore by highlighting two inspiring and important projects that exemplify the best of Drupal.
The first thing we'd like to introduce is OpenY, which is an amazing initiative within the YMCA movement that uses Drupal to support the Y's mission in a new way. OpenY is a philosophy that collaboration drives innovation and impact. It's a community of YMCAs and digital partners, and it is an open source digital platform for marketing and e-commerce, which was just recently released as a Drupal 8 distribution. So OpenY has grown from an idea to a movement that is encouraging collaboration between those of us in the Drupal community, many individual YMCA associations, as well as a number of technology partners, including ourselves. You can learn more about OpenY by visiting openymca.org, coming to the FFW booth, or you can also attend a couple of OpenY sessions that are happening at the con, as well as an OpenY sprint that's going on Friday. It's really been an amazing privilege for us to work with the YMCA to build this platform, and we really think it's such a great example of the wonderful things that open source can accomplish.
And we'd also like to highlight Global Training Days, a program started by the Drupal Association in 2012 to help bring Drupal learning to every corner of the globe. FFW has been proud to sponsor Global Training Days and provide training since 2012, and we've increased our contributions and our efforts every year since then. At the end of last year, Global Training Days transitioned to community leadership, and we'd like to ask each of you to help support Global Training Days and global Drupal adoption by attending our first DrupalCon working session right here tomorrow, room 312, after lunch at 2:15. Attend, visit the Global Training Day page on groups.drupal.org. Let Addison, Marina, Mauricio, Liz, and myself help you plan your first Global Training Day. If you're here and you're a newbie to Drupal, then your Global Training Day is all about joining the Drupal community. If you're experienced, it's all about learning and adopting and doing amazing things with Drupal.
And Global Training Days and OpenY are just two examples of what we know are just countless inspirational initiatives and projects going on within the community. And now that we're here at DrupalCon, we really have an amazing opportunity to continue to collaborate, come together, share, learn from each other. So no matter what part of the Drupal project or community you're involved with, we really hope that you take the opportunity to get involved, make the most of it, and have a wonderful week.
And with that, it is our privilege to introduce the founder of the Drupal project, Dries Boitart, who... Go ahead. Who, together with each one of us, has helped build a community that will continue to thrive around sharing, communication, and leadership. Thank you.
Thank you. Awesome. Thank you. Good morning, everybody. Good morning. It's a full house today, which is great to see. Before I go into sort of the key keynote, I guess, or the main part of the keynote, I did want to, say a few words. Let's see if this works. I did want to say a few words. I wanted to say that, that I've heard all of you, that we are going through some difficult times. And I just wanted to reassure you that I've really hurt you. You know, it pains me to see that the community is in pain. I love this community. And I'm happy to talk more about this during the Q&A. But we're also here with 3,000 people, and so I do believe that we owe it to the community to make this keynote about the software. So I'm going to talk about the software today, and then we can talk about these other things in the Q&A. Thank you. All right, so what I wanted to talk about today is Drupal 8. I'm going to start with some updates and thoughts about Drupal 8. And then specifically for the second part of the keynote, I'm going to talk about Drupal 8.3. As most of you probably know, we released Drupal 8.3 three weeks ago, roughly. And so I wanted to show you some of the new features as well as the improvements that we've made to Drupal 8.3. So let's get started. And I'll get started with the Drupal updates. Sorry, I have clicker problems. All right, so first of all, more and more sites are being launched in Drupal 8. I'm not sure if you've been keeping track of the usage statistics, but the last few months, or the past few months, we've been launching more than 15,000 websites every month. And so that number has been going up and up and up, which is great. And one of the things that a lot of these websites have in common is that they're much more ambitious. And so the YMCA was just mentioned, which is actually a very good example. And I wanted to talk a little bit more about that, actually, which is, I'm not sure if you know, but the YMCA serves almost 60 million people around the world. And the way they're organized is through sort of independent associations. There is over 870 of these associations. And they're run independently, so their own CEO, they have their own digital team, and all of these things. And so the YMCA of the greater Twin Cities, they basically decided to build this distribution that was just mentioned by FFW, the Open Y. And it's a Drupal 8 distribution, and it's a great showcase for Drupal 8 because what they can do with this distribution is not only deliver a website with all sorts of capabilities necessary for the YMCA, it also allows them to build mobile applications on top of that. It also allows them to power digital signage, and it even connects with some of the fitness gear, you know, the equipment, which is pretty cool that Drupal can now send information, content to fitness appliances. So it's a great example of the power of Drupal 8. But as mentioned by FFW, it's also a great example of the power of open source. Right, because this is not something that they could have done with proprietary software. The model that they created around collaborating on this distribution and sharing it with the other Ys is something that's very, very unique to open source and is definitely challenging sort of the prevailing model. And the YMC is just one example of an organization doing these things, but there is many more. And that's really, really fun and encouraging to see. What a lot of these Drupal 8 sites have in common is that they are for, you know, what I've called ambitious digital experiences. And the word ambitious is actually a term that we borrowed from the Ember community. And when I talk to people in my travels, there's a lot of talks about Drupal 7 versus Drupal 8. Some people are concerned about the adoption of Drupal 8. But what I almost never hear is people that actually have doubts about Drupal 8 itself and how great of a product Drupal 8 is. I don't think there's many people that argue that Drupal 7 is better than Drupal 8. What people do argue with sometimes is who is Drupal 4, right? And for better or worse, Drupal has evolved over the last 16, 17 years from being a project that I started in my dorm room that was really good for hobby projects to something that is, you know, much more powerful. And that's a very powerful platform for organizations like the YMCA. Some people have said that Drupal is for the enterprise. And while I agree that Drupal is a great fit for the enterprise, I actually never really liked that categorization. And that's why I think ambitious is a much better term, because there is a lot of small organizations. There is a lot of startups, for example. There is museums. There is universities that aren't necessarily enterprises that can still really benefit from Drupal, because what they're doing is ambitious, right? I think the market around us has changed quite a bit. And if you want to build a simple website, I'm not sure if it makes sense to use Drupal today. It probably sounds harsh to say, but it is sort of a fact, right? And it's not necessarily a fact that's within our control, just the way things have evolved. And so Drupal is really good for anything that is sort of an ambitious website or an ambitious digital experience. But I also believe our ecosystem is very ambitious. A lot of the companies, the Drupal agencies and the Drupal shops that I talk to, they have very ambitious plans. They want to do bigger and bigger projects, as an example. They want to innovate. And then our customers, our users, are also very ambitious, like the YMCA. And so I do believe that that is a good categorization of what Drupal is all about and what our strengths are. The other thing that I've seen in talking to a lot of the Drupal companies is that Drupal 8 has become the de facto release. I'm not sure if it's true for all of you, but for a lot of the organizations that I talk to, it has been. And in fact, as you might remember in my keynotes, I've sort of said that I really do believe that the adoption of Drupal 8 will take off, or would take off at the end of 2016. And I recently got a text message from John Faber, who is the CEO of Chapter 3. And he said, you know what, you are right. Like, every project that we do right now is on Drupal 8. And he even mentioned an example, which was the city of San Francisco. And they have a mandate now that every project, every website that the city of San Francisco launches has to be on Drupal 8. And I see that happening more and more and more. And so that's very exciting. Part of that has been driven by the module ecosystem. More and more of the contributed modules have been, are ready for Drupal 8. And there's a lot of great work being done by many of you in the community, so thank you for all your hard work on porting modules. Having said that, more work remains. There's still a good number of modules that need to be ported. So now is the time for everybody to start helping with porting these modules. We can't wait for other people to do it, in my opinion. And so this is a call for everyone to start helping porting the key modules that people need for Drupal 8. There's also about 1 million websites on Drupal 7 that still need to be migrated, which is a lot of websites. And a good amount of those websites are waiting for the migrate module to be, you know, ready. So the migrate modules are now part of Drupal core, which is great, but there's still a number of migrations that aren't finished, and there's also a number of bugs in the migrate modules that still need to be fixed. But once we fix those, that will really help a lot of organizations migrate their websites from Drupal 7 to Drupal 8. One thing that's been working extremely well, in my opinion, is the 6-month release cycles. I think many of you know, but with the release of Drupal 8, we decided to change our innovation model. Oops. One second. And so instead of doing these big bang releases every 4 or 5 years, like we did with Drupal 8, we've now adopted a different model where we do a new release every 6 months. And in those releases, we can actually add new capabilities, new features. We can do that in a couple of different ways, but one of those ways is through experimental modules. Not only can we innovate continuously, we've also committed to providing a smooth or easy upgrade path between these releases. And as I mentioned, this has been working extremely well. We released 8.1, 8.2, 8.3, and we shipped those on time as we promised we would, as we said we would. And this has been great for end users, but also been great for contributors and developers, because you no longer have to wait years for your new feature that you contributed to be able to be used in production. And because it's working so well, one of the things that we've decided is to translate the way we do these things from the minor releases. From the minor releases to major releases. And so what does that mean? Like, instead of doing this from 8.2 to 8.3, we've decided that we can also apply this as it relates to upgrading from Drupal 8 to eventually Drupal 9. This is a big deal because, you know, some of the biggest criticism that we hear around Drupal is that major upgrades are really, really hard, right? And it's hard because so much of the code needs to be rewritten, but it's also hard because of the learning curve. These are two different aspects that are really hard. And so we figured out a way to make that a lot easier. And so here's how that will work. So as we add new subsystems to, let's say, 8.4, we will deprecate some of the old APIs. And what that means is that instead of removing the old APIs or the old subsystems, we'll keep them in place. And we'll also keep maintaining them so that modules can use either the new or the old API. And we'll keep doing that for all of the minor releases. And so if you have a module, as I mentioned, it can either use the old deprecated API or it can use the new API. And we'll actually have some capabilities in our test bots that help developers figure out if they're using deprecated APIs. And so when you do, you're encouraged to migrate to the new API. Of course, if we keep doing that, over time, things will become more and more complex, and the code base will become bigger and bigger and bigger, and maintaining those layers of, you know, backwards compatibility will become increasingly more work. And so at some point, we're basically going to drop the support for these deprecated subsystems. And at that point, we're going to make that Drupal 9. And so effectively, Drupal 9 will be sort of the last Drupal 8 version minus a lot of the deprecated code. So it's kind of a clean slate, if you will, to start innovating again. So why that is great is shown on this slide. So if you have a module, a contributed module, a custom module, and if that module only uses non-deprecated APIs, it will actually work on Drupal 9. However, if it does still use deprecated APIs, it will obviously not run on Drupal 9, but we're giving effectively developers a lot of time to upgrade from their deprecated APIs to new APIs. And so we think that's very, very exciting, because what that means is that the upgrade from Drupal 8 to Drupal 9 eventually could be as easy as upgrading from 8.2 to 8.3, assuming modules don't use deprecated APIs, right? That's the assumption. And so the call to action is to developers to upgrade their modules continuously. And if we do that, then the upgrade from Drupal 7 to Drupal 8 might be the last really, really difficult upgrade, which in my mind is probably the biggest feature that we could add to Drupal 8. So, what do you think of that? Yeah. The other thing we've been doing is we've been adding more core committers to the team. And there's a couple of different reasons for that. One, as we add new capabilities, new features, obviously adding those new capabilities and features is extra work, because it's not something that we've done in the past. But also, as you all know, when you add a new feature, it's not sort of bug-free from day one. You know, new features introduce new bugs, and these bugs need to be managed and fixed. Secondly, As we get more users, and by that I mean as more and more organizations and people start adopting Drupal 8 and the adoption accelerates, we also discover more bugs. Doesn't mean there are more bugs necessarily, but it means that the discovery rate accelerates because a lot of people use Drupal in different edge cases and, you know, sort of untested configurations. And so we see an increase in bug reports, which again means more work. And then also this whole release process, we've really become much more mature, right? From the 6-month releases that we didn't have with Drupal 7, that means we have to manage multiple branches to what I just explained about how we eventually will upgrade to Drupal 9 and how we have to maintain those deprecated APIs. And what we're doing around product management, I haven't really talked about that, but we're making other improvements. All of that creates more work. And then fourth, you know, sometimes committers want to take a leave. You know, they want to go on vacation, they want to take a break. And we have to manage that as well. And so all of these reasons has really led us to sort of add more people and to really level up the team. By that, I don't mean that the previous team, or the old team, wasn't great. We just needed to add more capacity to help us manage all of these things. So now we have like a level 300 committer team, if you will, by adding 4 new people. And these have been announced already. And it's something that we've been doing over the years, actually. You can see the timeline here and the dates when we added more people. And so I just wanted to highlight real quick a couple of these new people. First person is Chris. Chris has been amazing. He's actually been a core committer since Dublin. Yeah. Chris has done a lot for Drupal, from core mentoring to other things, but in his role as a core committer, he's very focused on, let's say, release management. That's his key focus. And he already helped with multiple releases. We've also added Laurie. Laurie is great because he's really passionate about themers and usability and user-facing improvements and has been a long-term, you know, top contributor for Drupal. So, yeah. And then there is Gabor. Where do I even start with Gabor? Gabor won the Aaron Winborn Award, actually, for his many accolades and contributions to Drupal, from organizing events to the incredible work he's done on multilingual, which, by the way, he worked on the multilingual stuff with over 1,600 people. I mean, an incredible number of people have contributed to that. And also, Gabor has been a core committer for a long time, actually. He was a core maintainer of Drupal 6. And in fact, just last week was his 10-year anniversary since his very first commit. Yeah. So Gabor is back. And then there is Roy. And Roy is a big deal because it's actually the very first committer which is not a developer. And that's a huge milestone for us and something that we should have done many, many years ago. But you know, Roy will help us with everything usability, interaction design, information design, all of these things. So very, very excited to have all of these people on the team. There's a lot of other great things happening in the community with all of these people. And in fact, there is so many things that I could share, that I wish I could share, but that I can't share. But what I decided to do, I do wanted to spotlight a few other people that have done incredible work in our community. And so I'm gonna walk through a couple of those. First person is Keith. Let's see if I can get his slide up. And so Keith, on his own initiative, basically decided to really push forward the out-of-the-box experience of Drupal core specifically. And so the problem that he identified, and other people as well, but is that Drupal is incredibly powerful, and you can do so many things with it. But unfortunately, that power is not immediately obvious. Drupal can be hard to learn, can be hard to demo, all of these things. And so the solution that he proposed is to add a new theme to Drupal core. Not the default theme, just a new theme to Drupal core, along with sample content. So the idea is people could install it and see an actual site versus sort of an empty box. And so he's been working with others on this, and so they picked the idea of adding a magazine website install profile theme to Drupal core along with some default content. And it's a magazine website for cooking, actually, which is great because there is recipes, and recipes allow us to showcase the entity system and things like entity references, and it's kind of a good showcase for a lot of things in Drupal. And so I'll let Keith tell you a little bit more about that, but I'm very excited about it myself, and as you'll see, I also love Keith's passion and determination to make this happen.
Long story short is that I tried pretty much all of the content management systems that were around. The thing that struck me about Drupal is, in a way, it was a bit of a blank slate. I could make it do exactly what I needed it to do. It seemed to have a lot less restrictions. And then with that came the huge learning curve. And here we are. How many years later? 10 years later. Having sort of the same conversation, but approaching that and tackling that issue. I think the issue that we're working against is actually from 2006, the one we've just recently updated. So it's a conversation that's been long running. I've always felt that it would be nice to get involved in doing something where there was something out of the box. And I'd often see a few community members raising issue queue items on this sort of thing and saying, you know, wouldn't it be great if Drupal had something that was like demo example content. All this amazing functionality and rich features and effort that all of the core contributors have put into Drupal 8. But how do you tell the story in a way that allows users to immediately get what's going on and get on board? Because I think Drupal 8 is phenomenal. And I genuinely think that what you get out of the box in core is phenomenal. On that onboarding side, though, I think one of the key parts is Drupal's perception. It's something that Dries spoke about a lot over the last few years. And I think that there is a perception that we need to work on around Drupal and how hard it is to work with. But also to approach some of the simpler design patterns that we need to solve. Because if we can get those right, so many other parts in Drupal across all different types of projects can really benefit and show how Drupal as a content management system has actually really, you know, really come together in Drupal 8. That excites me because whether it's a tiny website, whether it's a large enterprise considering Drupal, making sure they get the right perception would be great. So something out of the box for them is really important. I think we've got clear goals, clear vision, and for that reason, I think it should be a great success.
All right, that's Keith. The next person I want to highlight real quick is Christina. Christina is a designer, front-end developer that has been a driving force behind the new admin status page in Drupal 8.3. And so improving this page, the status admin page, has been a long-standing issue. It's one of those issues on Drupal.org where there's been like hundreds of comments or over 100 comments, and she basically made it happen. Like, she really stepped in to make it happen. And so I'll let her talk about that a little bit.
Drupal is not that design-like at all. It's completely engineering-minded. I mean, everybody are engineers. They approach things like engineers, and things are okay. They pass the test or they don't pass the test. Things need to be in the issue queue, and everybody has an opinion about everything. And they needed someone. I was sitting with Roy and Bojan from the usability team, and they said, okay, we have this issue. We would like to have a better status page. I came up with some sketches, and when everything was okay for everyone, I designed the final. It was really awesome the other day because I was downloading and I completely forgot that it was actually there, and I just went to the page and I said, wow, that's the design, cool. I felt proud, but I don't feel like it's my design at all. It was there, someone had to do it, and I was there to do it. When you post something, hey, I've done this design, yeah, it's like on Facebook that adding a like is super easy. So I think it's something like that. It's a way for getting people involved, not only in design, but actually on usability, and having this small achievement with the status page is good because you actually see that something can be done.
There you go. Yeah. And great work. The next person is Sean. Sean Blomart. I can pronounce that because he's Dutch. Sean actually has been contributing to many different aspects of Drupal, from authentication stuff to multilingual and translation stuff to deployment-related things, and also more recently to the media initiative. And he's sort of one of the key contributors to media. And you know, obviously a lot of other people contribute to the media initiative, both in Contrib and Core, but he really helped pull sort of many things together and enabled meaningful progress on the media initiative. So he's gonna talk a little bit about that as well.
I was looking for like a way to be more involved in core development, and the media initiative, the thing I have been personally most frustrated about not being part of core yet, it was kind of a logical thing for me to work on. Still kind of weird that you can install a CMS in 2017 and not be able to just add a simple YouTube video or just reuse some files from a library. So I think that's something that, yeah, I think everybody knows should have been there a long time ago. Of course, you always need a group of people dedicated to work on this specific problem. And I think Contrib was doing a great job at it, but having that in core for everybody who installs Drupal and just being able to use some of the basic media handling, it's a very big win. It's a game changer for Drupal, I think. Every time we just push it a little bit forward, that maybe if you do enough of those small moments, then in the end, you can make like big changes. Because I learn a lot and I get connected with a lot of people I think highly of. So for me, it's cool to be involved with a group of people as smart as them. And that also helps me just be a better developer. And working on hard problems is always fun. I enjoy that. Maybe a little bit too much time sometimes, but yeah, you gotta have a hobby, right? What I would really like is for more people to join us, and that's important. We really appreciate everybody that's trying to help, and hopefully become just as passionate about this as we are.
Yeah. The media initiative is one of our strategic initiatives, which means it's one of our top priorities as a project, and that came out of the survey that I did a year ago. And so, yeah, please do get involved with this initiative. I think it's pretty exciting. The next person is Daniel. Daniel really jumped in to help with the inline form errors module, which is an experimental module. And as you know, if an experimental module doesn't make enough progress, it risks getting removed from core. And so Daniel felt that that would be a bad idea, and so really helped push the module forward. It's still an experimental module today, but if it wasn't for him, it might have been removed, and Drupal's accessibility and usability would have suffered. So here's Daniel.
I think as a Drupal as a CMS, it's really important that forms work well, because yeah, we need to input data, and if that doesn't really work and it's not really accessible, yeah, why are we a good CMS? So when I heard it would be removed from core, I put some extra effort in it to keep it in core. I'm not one of the initial writers of the module, but yeah, I really appreciate what they've done. So many people put effort in it. It would be such a waste if it got thrown out of core. It would be such a pity. Personally, I'm just somebody who wants to finish stuff. If I start on something, I just want to finish it. And I think especially this issue, I already mentioned that it touches so many aspects of Drupal. If you have to put in for a while some extra effort, I think it's worth it.
There you go. I have one more, and that is Matteo. He lives in Mallorca in Spain, which is an island. And he's been a long-term contributor as well. He's been contributing to the RESTful module in Drupal 7, is behind or one of the key contributors for the JSON API module in Drupal 8, which is something that we've talked about in previous keynotes. And in the interview, he also mentioned that he's really passionate about documentation, but he hates typing. And so he's been creating these video tutorials instead of writing documentation. And he shares those video tutorials with the world, and they've attracted quite an audience. And so he's all in all sort of a contributor extraordinaire. And I have a little video about him as well.
I live in a tiny town in a very small island in Spain. The other day, I got approached by someone, and he asked me, "Hey, are you Mateo?" And I was like, yeah, I was carrying my baby, because we went for a walk before that. And he recognized me and then stopped me and thanked me for one of the modules that I wrote and one of the videos that I made explaining that module, because that was very helpful for him. The odds are unbelievably low that someone in a super small town, in a tiny island, would use Drupal. And then we crossed paths and he recognized me. We're not in a city. Like, this could be reasonable if you are in the city, because that's where the tech jobs are. I live in the coast, and this guy was with a surfboard. Like, he was ready to go surfing, and he could live here and go surfing in the mornings and then work on this, because his job allowed to. And that's exactly what I appreciate about Drupal, which is this freedom to live where I want. That was really cool. That kind of got me thinking that there is a lot of reach on what we are doing. I should probably contact Luis and get that coffee that we never got around to share. But in general, the fuel is gratitude and also passion about the technology. Like, there is a lot of that, right? I really like solving the puzzle and sharing it with others. Then also getting to collaborate with, you know, with smart people that challenged you and that tell you, you probably shouldn't do that way. Look what I did. And then you go down that path and you realize, wow, there's this whole new other thing that I didn't know.
Yes, yeah. It's hard not to like him. And actually, while we were doing the interview, he got a tweet from somebody that thanked him for his tutorials, which was actually made it extra special. And so these are just a handful of stories. But to me, all of these people that you just saw are really, truly inspiring. You know, these are really great stories. And that makes me very proud. And like those five people, there's so many other people in our community, so many people doing great work that has big impact on many others. And I wish I could share more of those stories, and I'll try to share more of them in future keynotes as well. So some of the things you saw in these videos actually made it into Drupal 8.3, and so I'd like to segue to the second part of the keynote presentation right now, which is showing you what's new and improved in 8.3. As I mentioned in the beginning, it was released on April 5th, I think, so about 3 weeks ago. So it's hot off the press, as they say. And in order to show you what's new and improved, we basically built a Drupal 8 website for the Louvre, which is obviously a museum. And they have, in fact, a Drupal site today. I don't think it's in Drupal 8. I think it's in Drupal 7, but we kind of rebuild it for the purposes of this demo, and it looks roughly like this. And we're going to focus on the exhibition and events section of that website. All right. So before I go ahead, I wanted to give you a big warning. I hope you can read it in the back. But some of the things I'll show you are experimental modules. Right, and so these are modules in Drupal core. They come with the software, but they aren't stable modules. hopefully they will become stable modules in the future. But while they're experimental, you really shouldn't use them in production because we change the APIs. We don't guarantee upgrade paths. There could be some data loss. I mean, there's all sorts of things that could go wrong with these modules. But the reason that we have them is to allow quick feedback and to allow us to iterate quickly on those modules to learn, get feedback, and then eventually we make them stable. So with that out of the way, I wanted to get started. And first, we'll look at the site builder improvements. And for that, we'll use Jamie, and here we go. One thing Jamie wants to do is create different layouts for different types of content. Here you see a piece of content of the type exhibition. She wants to change this from a one-column layout to a three-column layout. And this is something that she can do with the new experimental field layout module. Over in the field settings for this content type, you can see the new layout settings. It's currently set to one column, and she's going to set it to three columns, and then move her fields around in the different columns. She's going to put the image field above the dates field, the body field in the middle, and the practical information field over on the right. So when Jamie saves, and then she goes back to the site, she can see that all of her fields are now in the three-column layout. So another thing that Jamie wants to do is set up a moderation workflow. What she wants is for authors to be able to write content but not publish it. She wants to be able to review first, and then she can decide to publish or not. Drupal 8.3's content moderation enables her to do exactly that. This site already has workflow enabled for the purposes of this demo. And workflow has also been enabled for this particular content type. So first, let's look at what one of the Louvre's authors, Henry, sees when he goes to edit this piece of content. With the default workflow enabled, he's going to see a create new draft option, a save and publish option, and a save and archive option. Now let's see what it looks like to actually configure one of these workflows. Here you can see the states. The first thing Jamie wants to do is add a new state. She will call it ready to review, and she's going to make it the default revision, but not published. In addition to a state, she's also going to need to create a new transition. She's going to call that transition mark ready to review. Now, let's go back and look to see what the author will see when he goes to submit content. Now, when our author, Henry, goes to edit this piece of content, he will see that he has the option to just save or to save and mark as ready to review. He does not see the save and publish or archive options because he's looking at a draft, and the only transitions from draft are save draft and mark ready to review. Awesome. Yeah. I considered lip syncing, but it was too hard. Yeah, these are some great new additions to Drupal. And we can now do that in a way that is continuous, right? Instead of having to wait for years to get some of these features into core, this model is really working, and I think should be really exciting to a lot of people. All right, next is Henry, I should probably say, and he's the content author, and so we're going to look at some of the improvements for him. Looking at the experience for content author Henry, one of the really nice things in 8.3 is the updated CK Editor 4, which has a completely new look and feel. To give you an idea of what kind of improvement this is, let's look at the old toolbar. As you can see, it didn't fit into Drupal's visual style and looked a little bit dated. The Date Ranges module was added in Drupal 8.2 and has seen many improvements during the experimental module process. The out-of-the-box date field did not give you the ability to create date ranges and to specify a start and an end date, but now in Drupal 8.3, you do have that capability. In this particular instance, this comes in super handy because exhibitions have a start and an end date. We also have the experimental module for inline form errors, and this module saw a lot of improvements in Drupal 8.3. And what it does is it puts the form errors in context instead of putting it at the top of the page. So here, if the author removes the alternative text, which is a required field, and then previews, he's going to see the error message right next to the field and not just at the top of the page. Another neat improvement is better functionality for quick editing image fields. As you can see, quick editing image fields no longer show a form. Instead, it supports drag and drop image uploads. So let me demonstrate that by grabbing another image to replace this one. Setting alternative text is still possible, and it's possible without having to go in the full image form. Now we can just save it.
All right. So lots of great improvements for authors, which is a very important audience for us, obviously. I was actually at, I think it was CBS once, and got a little tour, and I came into, I guess, their office or their floor, and they're using Drupal, and there's like, I don't even remember how many people, but there's like hundreds of people, and I said, wow, all these people, hundreds of people, what they do all day long is enter content into Drupal. So it just goes to show, of some of these small improvements can really benefit a lot of people. Next is the end user, which
let's say that I'm a member of the museum and that of a member page. This page is going to have content that is dynamically generated just for me. What this means is that the page can be cached and that Drupal will have to build it on the fly. Using older versions of Drupal, this page might load slowly. I wouldn't have the ability to interact with the page until it was fully loaded, and I wouldn't see that it was loading apart from the browser spinner. Now with BigPipe, personalized parts of this page can load after the majority of the page has already loaded. You can see that clearly when I refresh the page. You might have seen these gray boxes on other sites, like Facebook. It's something that's called optimistic feedback. It allows me to start interacting with parts of the page that have already loaded, like this member feedback area. And the majority of the page is not personalized after all.
Awesome. So BigPipe is something that we've talked about for a while and was an experimental module, but is now a stable module. So it's now available for everybody to use. Another big trend for end users or end user experiences is that we are moving beyond the page, right? What I mean by that is that it's no longer enough to just have a website. Obviously, a lot of organizations have a mobile application in addition to a website, but increasingly more, we're starting to see things like chatbots or interactive kiosks or voice assistants, these kinds of things. And so for the purpose of this keynote, we created a chatbot for the Louvre, and the content that is used in the chatbot is obviously powered by Drupal and can be updated in real time. And the integration between the chatbot and Drupal, is the result of the REST API. So here's a little video.
Now, as a member of the museum, maybe when I'm not at the museum, I want to go check what other exhibitions they have, as well as maybe book a ticket. So luckily, I can do that with this chatbot. The chatbot was built for the purpose of this demo. This chatbot is enabled by an integration of the Facebook Messenger bot module that was originally created by the White House under the Obama administration and released on GitHub. And so the process of creating this bot involved installing the module and configuring the appropriate webhooks. The bot content can be updated in real time from within Drupal. What makes this relatively easy is Drupal's strong focus on structured content and data modeling. And so this is awesome because it shows what's possible with Drupal's REST API and a little bit of tinkering. In the future, we hope to integrate this with an artificial intelligence natural language framework. This will allow the questions to become much more complex and the answers to become much more rich.
There we go. So these things are now not hard anymore. Sorry, So these things are now becoming much, much easier. And so if you want to play around with it, you can just go download the module from GitHub and test it out. And so I think what I think is exciting, at least to me, is that the power of Drupal, as it stands today, is that you can use Drupal to build traditional or coupled websites, like the one that I showed you for the Louvre, as well as integrate with alternative front-end technologies. And I do personally believe that organizations want both. You know, people want to have a normal website, and then they want to do these other things. And I don't believe that an API-only approach is necessarily the best approach for most organizations. There's a lot of sort of, you know, hype, if you will, around, you know, solutions like Contentful or Prismic.io, and while they're great and they have their own purpose, I do believe that this hybrid model where we can do coupled and decoupled is actually the best way to go. And the reason is because if you do a traditional website or a coupled approach, there's a lot of things which you don't want to lose that you would lose with a decoupled approach, from years and years of refinement around accessibility features to layout management to in-place editing to SEO optimization to, you know, the big pipe caching. I mean, there's so much that Drupal provides that you lose if you go completely decoupled. And while that's probably a good thing in some cases, I don't think it's the best thing to do in all cases. And so being able to support the spectrum is a real advantage compared to these other systems. And so next, I wanted to showcase Preston So. Preston has been helping with the API First initiative, and specifically has done a lot of work on promoting it. He's traveled all around the world. He traveled to India, he's traveled to Latin America, he's traveled to Europe, North America, and he's been presenting about this initiative to everyone, and all in their local language too, by the way. So if you don't know Preston, I think he speaks like 15 different languages. If he goes somewhere new, he quickly learns the local language. How he does it, I don't know. But he's been a great evangelist for API First and then some, not just evangelist.
One of the things I see myself as doing is to really represent and evangelize and showcase as often as I can the work that the API First initiative is doing, so that people not only understand it and have a really good handle on what's happening and how they can access these features, but also to recognize the hard work that's been put into the initiative by all of those individuals and to help them. One of the most rewarding moments at any Drupal event that I've been to was really DrupalCon Mumbai. It was one of the most important events, not just in my career, but in my life, because I got to meet so many people who had only seen me as a handle or had only seen me as this amorphous person giving these presentations. And finally being able to stand up in front of this audience and give a presentation. My topic was about decoupled Drupal. And I still remember this like it was yesterday. Someone walked up to me afterwards and said, you know, number one, you've totally changed my perception of what Drupal can do. But number two, you've made me so excited about Drupal again, because there's this whole world, this whole universe of potential that Drupal has. Those kinds of small wins are the uncelebrated wins. Those are incrementally actually the most important part of what advances Drupal, in my opinion. So I'd encourage anyone who's looking to do some more of this kind of evangelism or speaking, especially in Drupal cons or at Drupal camps, reach out to your local meetup, find a local Drupal group, start giving some lightning talks, present about a topic that you're interested in. It doesn't even have to be about Drupal, it could be about your cat, I'm just kidding. But anything that you're interested in that you think is really useful for everyone else to share is, I think, a very good first approach.
Lots of great progress on the API First initiative. And for me personally, you know, I think this is one of the most exciting things we're doing. I think it's actually one of the most exciting times to be part of the web. I personally believe that new platforms only come around every 10 years or so. And I believe that the last big platform was mobile, right? If you think about mobile, that's about 10 years ago. And what happened is, first, we had to build a lot of technology. HTML5, responsive design, different languages for mobile applications. I mean, there's a lot of technology that had to be put in place. And once we had the technology, we could start to reimagine, you know, user experiences, customer experiences, and eventually also reimagine, you know, business models. If you think about Lyft or Uber, these kinds of companies, they would not have been able to exist before this technology was built. And so what I feel is happening right now with conversational user interfaces, whether it's chatbots or voice assistants like Amazon Echo, is that we're building the technology and we're starting to reimagine the customer experiences as well. And it's not too hard to, you know, think about what some of the future could look like. You know, if you think about customer support as an example, I mean, all of us from time to time have to call a customer support line. And very often that can be frustrating, right? You have to, first you have to call them between 9 and 5, and then you have to wait on the phone until somebody's available. And then you get somebody on the phone and they have not great product knowledge. And so now that needs to be escalated. I mean, it can be frustrating. If you think about what you can do with a voice assistant, you know, well, you would be able to ask questions 24/7, 0-8, and you get, you know, a voice, I guess, that has perfect product knowledge, right? And so it's not too difficult to imagine how some of these technologies will really change our lives as well as business models and all of these things. And conversational UIs can be at the core of this. And a bunch of big companies, from Apple to Facebook to Google to Amazon, they're really, really investing in these things to try and make it a platform. And so I think it's right ahead of us. And I think Drupal can play a significant role in powering a lot of the content that goes into these experiences. And so it's about moving beyond the page to not just serve websites, but also all sorts of other user interfaces. And to me, that is exciting. And the technology becomes more and more accessible as you saw with the chatbot. And so here's a quick summary of the different things I've shown you. I hope you liked it. What did you think overall? Did you like it? Yeah? A lot of people helped to make this happen. You know, thousands of people contributed to all of these things. And so with that, I would like to conclude my keynote and go into the Q&A. Thank you.
I hope this mic works. Is it working?
It works.
Yeah. Okay, great. All right, I have a whole bunch of questions, but we have a limited amount of time, so we have some technology questions, but also some people, community questions. I think we'll start with the community ones, because those are really salient right now. Recent events in the community have led many people to wonder, both publicly and in private, if there's room for them in the community. What would you say to those who are feeling marginalized or at risk right now?
That's a great question. Well, first of all, I would say, you know, that I understand that there is fear and concerns in the community. I recognize that. I also want to apologize for my communication that contributed to that. That was never my intent. I would say that we really try to build a community that's inclusive. And I would say that it's very rare that these events happen, or that we ask somebody to leave. And so it's not, you know, not something that happens a lot. And so, yeah.
It's been pointed out in multiple places that you wear a lot of hats. And in many meaningful structures of Drupal, all roads basically lead to Dries. Mm-hmm. Do you feel that's a good place for the community to be in now? What's the future of Drees as figurehead across all these orgs?
It's a great question. I don't necessarily think that's a good place for me to be in, just to be very clear. I think a lot of this is historical. Like, you have to remember, when I started Drupal, I did everything. You know, I ran the server, I helped organize the events. I mean, so I did everything, and over the years, I actually have delegated a lot. Like, we created the Drupal Association, we've created community working groups, and so our history is one where, you know, I've tried to, you know, delegate things to other people. Having said that, we need to keep evolving that, right? We need to keep looking at what makes sense for me to do and what doesn't make sense for me to do. And I think that's why this week we're going to spend a lot of time talking about the governance to figure out, as a community, how we move things forward in a way that's best for the community, as well as for me, frankly, because, as an example, I do not want to be the escalation point for certain community decisions. Like, I really don't want to do that. It just happened to be the case that that was still in place, right? And so I'm as excited about everybody else, I think, to figure out how to best evolve our governance model and the different hats and how we put in place the right, checks and balances and these kinds of things.
So I'll ask a little more personal question for this last one here about the community. You showed a lot of slides with a lot of contributors from throughout the world, but we're still, quite frankly, mostly white, mostly male. And I have an ongoing joke about there being three of us. If Jason Yee and Preston So are out there, we get confused for each other a lot, all the time. I was actually called Preston yesterday, which is really funny. I'm waiting until somebody calls me Jason on accident. And so when I go, and I have a lot of friends out in the Drupal community, and a lot of them from spread throughout the world, but I don't see a lot of people that look like me. How can we make that better?
Yeah, it's a great point. I think we have a lot of work to do on diversity, personally, and I'm not just talking about gender diversity, you know, but all sorts of diversity. And I think it's really important to do that work, because I really do believe that if we have a more diverse community, we'll get more different viewpoints, different kinds of inputs, and that will make us better and stronger. So it's really a feature, if you will, and not a bug. The question of how to improve diversity is a difficult one, I guess, at least for me, because I'm not an expert on that necessarily. I recognize that's important. I want us to work on that. And I would say a couple of things. My initial reaction, again, not being an expert, would be to start with measuring what our diversity is today. If we understand how diverse we are along different dimensions, at least we can start to see it and talk about it. And then hopefully we can set some goals on how to improve diversity and then figure out ways to do that, right? So it's sort of like, what's the framework of getting there? And then I would say we should work with people that are really good at this. And as of about a year ago, we have the Diversity and Inclusion Working Group, which has a lot of people very passionate about this, that know much more about this than me, and we should really work with them and help and allow them to help us figure out how to make this happen. That would be my sort of initial reaction.
Okay, we'll do one more. We'll talk about technology for this one. You showed a demo, or a number of demos, that were very feature-rich, highly product-managed, and they bring a lot of features that would otherwise, in previous eras, been done in Contrib into Core. As Core gets bigger and more full-featured and more of a complete product, how does that change the Drupal ecosystem? And how does Drupal grow now that it's being grown in a much more directed fashion?
Okay, that's a good question. Trying to unpack the question a little bit. I think, you know, Core has been getting bigger and bigger. I believe that's been driven by user demands. Like, we do these surveys, and these surveys, you know, say, you know, here's all the things people want. And then we figure out a way to You know, does it make sense to add these things to core, yes or no? And usually, excuse me, the things we add to core are sort of foundational pieces of technology, meaning something that everybody wants, and often it's something that can be used by contributed modules to build upon. So that's roughly kind of the things we add in core, like the settings tray as an example, which I actually didn't demo, is something that we hope to put in core so that every other contributed module will start using that. Or the media things in the media initiative that we want to put in core. You know, step one is the media entity type, which is sort of a foundational piece of technology that then can be used by contributed modules to do all sorts of interesting things on top of. And so the decision to move something in core is something that we talk a lot about with the core committer teams and the community. But ultimately, we think that's a good idea because, one, it makes Drupal a better product. Two, it provides a solid foundation for a lot of contributed modules. You know, three, frankly, a lot of people expect those things to be there out of the box. That's how it happens. And in doing so, core gets bigger. But it also becomes a more mature, stable product, which I think is ultimately what a lot of our end users want.
Do you think that leads to a wait-and-see approach for the contrib space, if they feel that core is going to do all the heavy lifting experiment-wise?
What do you mean with wait-and-see?
Well, if core is going to be more aggressive in its product definition, right? Well, we'll defer those decisions to the core experiment process and wait it out in contrib.
I hope not, because we're adding a bunch of things to core, but I think the things we're focused on right now are going to be the things we're going to be focused on for a while, so I don't see us adding a whole lot of new things on top of the things we're doing. Mm-hmm. So I would expect that people keep innovating in contrib, as well as help with the things that we're currently trying to add to core. So I don't expect us to, you know, sort of rapidly add a lot of things to core. I think it will be a steady, deliberate, careful process. I don't think it will spin out of control, I guess, where people feel like, oh no, it doesn't make sense for me to add something as a contributed module.
Okay.
Awesome.
Okay, yeah.
All right.
We're getting the wave.
Sorry, awesome.